بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. طبعا النهاردة الحلقة الرابعة، وده يعني مسج قوية جدا من الدكتورة وسام الحماس. وفعلا احنا بقينا مور اورينتد للباثولوجي، لان النفروباثولوجي ده انتجريتف بارت من النفرولوجي براكتس، ولا يمكن ابدا ابدا ابقى دكتور كويس في الكلى من غير ما ابقى اوير بالنفروباثولوجي، لان البيوبسي ده انفيزيف، لابد ابقى عارف انا باخد من الانفيزيف مانوفر ايه. والدكتوره وسام فعلا اثبتت من خلال الحلقات السابقه انها خير من يتكلم في النفروباثولوجي. فالنهارده هنكمل المشوار مع very hot issues في الجلوميرولونيفرايتس، اللي هو طبعا الام بي جي ان 3 البوست انفكشن. طبعا الانفكشن جلوميرولونيفرايتس مستحيل ان احنا ندرك كل الانفكشنز، ده من the most difficult issue في النفرولوجي in general، انفكشن ريليتد سواء في كلينيكال نفرولوجي دياليس ترانسبلانتيشن، ده شيء صعب جدا. لكن الدكتور وسام ان شاء الله هتتناول الموضوع ده برشاقه. انا مش عاوز اطول عن كده، متشكرين جدا دكتور وسام، والمايك مع حضرتك، اتفضل.
العافية دكتور حسين، السلام عليكم جميعا. صوتي واضح؟
واضح جدا.
طيب تمام. احنا النهارده هنتكلم على يعني what's considered a recent entity in medicine, also a recent and a very important entity in nephrology, an entity which changed actually our point of view regarding very known diseases we already knew. I don't think that the time is going to allow to cover the full spectrum of infection-related kidney diseases, so we will leave this to the next time, inshallah. However, today I'm going to focus on what we consider C3 dominant glomerulonephritis, going through membranoproliferative GN, a very quick look at acute post-infectious GN, and with a focus on complement C3 glomerulonephritis. Okay, now complement and tissue injury, or what we what we call complement-related diseases, is a recent, relatively recent implementation in medicine, and actually covered a broad spectrum of mainly all diseases we used to know, but we did not know the pathogenesis of, which were included under this entity. For example, like senile-related macular degeneration, like paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria, adult respiratory distress syndrome, and so on. So these are all pathologies in which complement is activated. Let me remind you with complement, and that complement has three pathways: classical, lectin, and alternative pathway, and that the main functions of complement were the safe disposal of immune complexes and apoptotic cells, opsonization, leukocyte activation, it augments antibody response. C5a is an aflatoxin. We have a membrane attack complex which causes membrane damage cell lysis. However, recently we have disclosed other important functions of complement, like regulation of the adaptive immune response, promotion of tissue regeneration angiogenesis, mobilization of stem cells, proper development of the central nervous system, and control of embryo implantation. Whatever the pathway that the complement is activated with, the important thing is that we end up by formation of what we call C5 convertase, or C3B factor, complement factor B complex if the alternative pathway is activated, or C4B C2A complex if the classical or lectin pathway is activated. The main player here is C3 fragment B, together with factor B, complement factor B, and complement factor D, which are very important for stabilization and for cleavage of C3. And all of them that will end in forming the terminal membrane attack complex, which is from C5 to C9, or what we call MAC. Classical pathway is activated by immune complex formation, lectin pathway by bacterial carbohydrate and other degrading factors, while the alternative pathway is actually always on. And this is an important point you need to remember. Because it's always, because of all of these factors, and because we have a pathway of complement which is always on, complement regulation, we have so many numerous factors which regulate complement. And complement regulation is a very important mechanism. Some of them mainly focuses on the classical pathway, some of them mainly for the lectin pathway. However, some factors could work on the C5 convertase and on the assembly of the membrane itself complex. The most important factors are factor H and factor I for complement regulation, in addition to the decay accelerating factor, complement receptor 1, CD59, and so on. In the kidney, which is our main focus, the main complement-associated renal diseases would are some which consider activation of the classical pathway. Of the classical pathway, like lupus nephritis, post-streptococcal glomerulonephritis, good posture syndrome. Others, where the mechanism is mainly the activation of the alternative pathway, like C3-glomerulopathies, Shigella-associated HUS, atypical HUS, or tubular interstitial injury in proteinuric progressive glomerulopathies, and others where you have activation of one or more pathways, like IgA nephropathy, where we have the classic and the alternative pathway, same for ANCA, same for MPGN type 1, or like membranous, where you can activate actually the three pathways, or like ischemic reperfusion injury, which is mainly an alternative pathway and lectin pathway activation. So this is what we know, that these glomerulonephritis actually activate or works through the activation of these complement pathways. But in these specific glomerulonephritis, like post-streptococcal glomerulonephritis, which is classic pathway, NPGN, C3 glomerulopathies, and atypical HUS, do we have contribution of the complement to tissue injury? So it's not only a matter of activation of the complement, but do the complement deposits actually contribute to tissue injury? This is what we're mainly going to discuss. And I'll start with membrane proliferative glomerulonephritis. As the name implies, membrano means thickened basement membrane or double contours, and proliferative refers to mesangial proliferation. Again, this pattern of glomerulonephritis was first described by Richard Wright in 1820, followed by Follner in 1914. However, the first modern description was done by René Habib in 1961. So this is one of the oldest patterns which were described in the history of glomerulonephritis. Other names, as I've discussed earlier, were mesangiocapillary, hypocomplementic, and lobular glomerulonephritis, most of them obsolete for use. Membrane proliferative, as you know better than me, has a very variable clinical presentation, and this will be very important for our discussion today. So patients can be proteinuric, nephrotic, nephritic, hematuric, hypocomplementic. They could have an increased ASO2-titrate. They could present with an RPGN or chronic kidney disease. This variable clinical presentation could present differences in the pathogenesis of the disorder, which is a great possibility, but also could present differences in the timing of the diagnostic biopsy relative to the clinical course. That means that these patients are actually progressive and their clinical course can change with together with their morphology. A classic MPGN pattern means that I have mesangial proliferation, which outgrows the mesangial areas and become interposed between the glomerular basement membrane and the endothelium, resulting in this classic pattern. So in morphology, we get mesangial hypercellularity with or without mesangial matrix increase. The older the lesion, the more you have matrix increase, and sometimes endocapillary proliferation as well. So the endothelial cells also gets proliferating with the mesangium. We have capillary wall remodeling, double contours or duplication. This capillary wall remodeling, as you can see here, is mainly due to the interposition of the mesangium. So it's not, and this interposition of the mesangium leads to the formation of a new glomerular basement membrane. So this is not due to that the mesangium splits the glomerular basement membrane. So it's not splitting GBM. This is duplication of the GBM, and it's not a reduplication because they are not four, they are only two. So this is actually what happens in MPGN. And as you would see, that irritation of the endothelium or of the glomerular membrane in general leads to formation of new glomerular basement membrane material, as we're going to see in other diseases, inshallah. So the process here is basically mesangial hypercellularity and duplication due to interposition of the mesangium, which will eventually also lead to lobular accentuation. As you can see, silver stain, this is lobular accentuation, of the glomeruli, so they become more lobulated. And PGN actually does not only have a variable clinical presentation, but also have a variable morphological features, because it depends on the stage you're biopsying in. So the classic one is that you get this florid mesangial hypercellularity and capillary basement membrane duplication. But you can also get, as I mentioned, an endocapillary proliferation and intercapillary leukocytes with a lot of neutrophils. You can catch it earlier where you can hardly see the glomerular basement membrane duplication. It's very rare, like here. And the more prominent pattern is the mesangial proliferation and the endocapillary hypercellularity. So this does not look like your regular MPGN. Or you can catch it at a later stage where most of what you have is actually the mesangial matrix increase with a minimal proliferation and what would go under a nodular sclerosis pattern, as you can see here, with early nodular formation. By immuno, MPGN is mainly C3 positive. It can be subendothelial, mesangial, as you can see here, or subendothelial. And IgG or IgM would give the same pattern of deposits, however, with a less intensity than C3. So this is why, apart from the fact that it's called hypocomplementic glomerulonephritis, it is C3 dominant glomerulonephritis. So the main icon in diagnosing it by immuno is the C3 deposits plus the IgG and IgM. Sometimes they are also intense, but always the C3 is more intense. And this is by immunofluorescence. Again, the C3, you can see extensive, actually very impressive C3 deposits. MPGN has always been traditionally classified over two decades by type 1, type 2, and type 3 MPGN. Type 1 is the one we get IgG and C3. However, in type 2, which is dense deposit, was distinguished by deposits of C3 only. And type 3, which had two subtypes, the Burkholder variant and the Strife and Anders variant. The Burkholder variant typically had deposits of IgG and C3, while Strife and Anders could manifest C3 either alone or combination with either immunoglobulins. This was mainly an electron microscopy diagnosis, classification, and this classification was cumbersome to use, very perplexing and confusing to both clinicians and pathologists, and it really did not tell us anything. At the end of the day, they were all included under the same category, which was MPGN, in spite of their different immunofluorescence patterns. Let's start with type 2 DDZ, the dense deposit disease, which was distinguished by deposits of C3 only. Now, dense deposits is basically characterized by that you've got electron-dense osmophilic deposits in the basement membrane, whether diffuse or segmental. But these deposits could also be seen in the Bowman's capsule and in tubular basement membranes. Dense deposit, what did we know about it? We know that it's a rare disease. It occurs mainly in children and young adults. It affects both genders equally. It would present by nephritic, nephrotic syndrome, or renal insufficiency, and has a very poor prognosis. 50% ends with end-stage renal disease within 10 years, and have 100% recurrence post-transplant. Its pathogenesis, we've always recognized its pathogenesis, and we know that it's loss of complement regulation. We know that these patients have circulating C3 nephritic factor, and we know also that they have mutations of factor H gene, which is one of the main regulating factors of complement. So these dense deposits are not of immune complex origin. Actually, they are not deposits. They're just alterations in the basement membrane material. And these alterations occur also in the retina, in the retinal pigment epithelium, in the brush membrane, as the same alterations which happens in the glomerular basement membrane. Now, although dense deposit disease is an electron microscopy diagnosis, but it does give a very characteristic picture on light microscopy. This wrinkling of the basement membrane actually is highly suggestive or almost characteristic of dense deposit disease. By silver, you can actually see the deposits. This is the glomerular basement membrane, which is black, and this is the deposits all stained in pink, no, there is no remnant glomerular basement membrane. Again, you all the enzyme and in the glomerular basement membrane. Even by PAS, you can still recognize all the dense deposits in the glomerular basement membrane. Here, dense deposit disease can present by crescentic pattern or by mesangial proliferative pattern or by a membranoproliferative pattern. It's very variable in its presentation, but whatever the presentation is, as in this case, you can still recognize the sprinkling of the glomerular basement membranes. In mesangial proliferation, look at the globally sclerosed glomerulus and see the basement membranes markedly wrinkled. Again, here you can see the dense deposits all through and also in the tubules. By the silver, you can see also the dense deposits in the tubules. Of course, by immuno, you get widespread deposition of C3, and also by immunoperoxidase, very impressive pattern. You can actually recognize even the subepithelial humps on the immuno setting with extensive C3 deposits along glomerular basement membranes and in the mesangium. And by EM, you get the segmental or diffuse intramembranous osmophilic deposits, and frequently you get subepithelial humps like the ones first, the ones described in post-infectious glomerulonephritis. In 2007, a collaborative study led by the Renal Pathology Society defined five variants of dense deposit disease. They have examined 69 patients, which was one of the largest cohorts of dense deposit cases, and only 25% of them had a membranoproliferative pattern. As you can see, this is out of the 69 cases, 25 had MPGN, 18 had crescentic pattern, 12% presented as a typical acute a proliferative glomerulonephritis, exudative like the post-infectious, and up to 50% presented only with mesangial proliferation. This was also documented in the Columbia series, where they discovered, where they studied 32 cases with the same distribution, but they had more of a membranoproliferative pattern in their case series. And there was also a fifth pattern, which was unclassified, meaning that it even had an unclassified or undetermined pattern on light microscopy. Because of all of these findings, dense deposit disease should not be considered membranoproliferative glomerulonephritis. It has different clinical symptoms, it has different pathogenesis, different prognosis, and has a very high incidence of recurrence post-transplant. This was coincided within the same group of years by our discovery of complement-associated diseases, which was a major breakthrough in medicine, as I've mentioned early in the presentation. And deficiencies or mutations in complement regulatory proteins have led to the identification that you can get isolated C3 deposits within the kidney with different studies following this pattern. And so we had to have a fresh look on what we consider membranoproliferative glomerulonephritis, and a MPGN was reclassified. Now, I think, just a second, yes. So these disorders of complement have been basically either that you have activation protein deficiency, so you have too little complement, or you have a regulatory protein deficiency where you have too much complement. And this was the main pillar which provides diseases in where you can see complement deposits. And of course, the main culprit were the mutations of in the factor H family. So it all depends on physiological control of complement activation. You have a mild balance between regulators and activators. So in regulators, you lead to loss of function, and activators, you lead to gain of function. This balance would be influenced by mutations, so you get extreme patterns of diseases, and or polymorphisms and polymorphisms mainly work through fine tuning. So these patients could represent a different age, different clinical presentation, and variable morphologies. However, both the mutations and the polymorphisms are associated with renal diseases. Because of all of this evidence, MPGN has been reclassified not according to its light microscopy and electron microscopy pattern as the traditional classification, but according to its immunohistochemistry or immunofluorescence pattern. So what we considered MPG and type 1, which was mesangial, which is mesangial proliferation, GPM duplication, and by electron microscopy, you get mesangial and subendothelial deposits. By immuno, you will get C3 plus IgG and IgM and C1q, and this will be MPGN type 1. However, type 2, you get diverse histology, you get mesangial and intramembranous deposits, and by immuno, you get C3 only. So this is what's characterized by dense deposit disease and C3 glomerulopathy. Type 3 is MPGN with membranous features. Here you get mesangial deposits, subendothelial deposits, subepithelial deposits, and intramembranous deposits. And if it has immune complexes, then it's MPGN type 3. If it's C3 only, then it's C3 glomerulonephritis. Same also for MPGN 1. So again, if I have an MPGN with mesangial and subendothelial deposits only, and immune showed C3 and immune complexes, then it's membrane proliferative glomerulonephritis. If it's C3 only, then it's C3 glomerulonephritis. If it's type 3 and I have mesangial subendothelial and subepithelial deposits and I have immune complexes with the C3, then it's MPGN. If it's C3 only, then it's C3 glomerulonephritis. If it has a diverse histology or it's not only MPGN, and I have mesangial and intramembranous deposits and have, again, only C3 by immunostaining, then it's dense deposit disease. So within this, the C3 glomerulonephritis, dense deposit disease are called C3 glomerulopathy. So MPGN pattern of disease is now either immune complex mediated membrane proliferative GN or C3 or complement mediated membrane proliferative glomerulonephritis. So C3 glomerulopathy is considered a recent introduced term that encompasses glomerular disease originally characterized by the accumulation of C3 in the glomeruli without significant deposition of C1q and C4 and with minimal or no immunoglobulin. So you get evidence only which implies uncontrolled activation of the alternative pathway of complement. As I mentioned, this type of glomerulonephritis is very important to be distinct, differentiated from immune complex accumulation in glomeruli that will contain immunoglobulins as well as complement and oftenly also other factors which involves classic pathway activation. And also needs to be distinct, differentiated from other forms of complement-mediated renal disease like thrombotic microangiopathy in atypical hemolytic uremic syndrome. Because in TME, you are not going to get C3 deposits in the glomeruli. So C3 glomerulopathy or C3 glomerulonephritis is only when you have C3 deposits in the glomeruli. While, although atypical hemolytic uremic syndrome is also a complement-mediated disorder, but you do not get C3 deposits in the glomeruli. Because I get asked this question a lot. We want to stain for C3 to know if this TMA is atypical hemolytic uremic syndrome or not. Unfortunately, you can't. Why is that? Because the impaired regulation is different. Both are defects of complement regulation. But in C3 glomerulonephritis, the complement regulation is systemic. It's in the plasma, and it's mainly dysregulation of C3 convertase. So you get the C3 deposits, and you get glomerulonephritis. However, in hemolytic uremic syndrome, the impaired regulation occurs on cell surfaces. It's local, and also you get this regulation of C5 convertase, but you do not get any immune deposits to detect, and the main mechanism is endothelial damage, which would lead to thrombosis. They are both mutations in the same regulatory protein of factor H, but in different parts. In C3 glomerulonephritis or C3 glomerulopathy, like in dense deposit disease, the problem is in the C-terminal, so it affects the plasma regulation. So it's in the C-terminal of the gene. So it affects this plasma regulation. While in atypical hemolytic uremic syndrome, it's in the N-terminal, so this regulation is on cell surface, and it leads to endothelial injury. So unfortunately, we cannot know if it's an atypical HUS from the biopsy. We can only recognize C3 glomerulonephritis. One of the main of the earliest papers which have recognized C3 glomerulopathy was the identification of the mutation in complement factor H-related protein 5 in patients in a Cyprus island. And this was characterized as C5-HR5 related nephropathy. These patients had also recurrence of this nephropathy in a renal transplant. And their biopsies, they had mainly mesangial proliferation, and this mesangial proliferation was mainly characterized by the deposits of the C3 in the biopsy. You can see here, they had mainly mesangial proliferation. It was mainly a mesangial rift of glomerulonephritis and positive C3 in the mesangium. So the new classification of C3 glomerulopathy encompassed as well C5-HR5 nephropathy. So C3 glomerulopathy as an entity encompasses dense deposit disease, C3 glomerulonephritis, which can go with an MPGN pattern with only C3 deposits, and C5-HR5 nephropathy. The light microscopy of this group of diseases is variable. Yes, around 75% of them is MPGN. However, as I mentioned, they can have mesangial proliferation. They can have endocapillary and diffuse proliferative like post-infectious glomerulonephritis exactly, and they can have a crescentic form. At the ultrastructure level, we can detect all types of deposits, subendothelial, mesangial, intramembranous, subepithelial, depends on how you want what the underlying pathogenesis or the classification of the disease. If we want to classify it pathologically wise, we classify it into dense deposit disease and C3 glomerulonephritis. Dense deposit disease will be MPGN type 2 and the C5H5 related glomerulopathy if it has a mesangial proliferative or a proliferative pattern. While C3 glomerulonephritis will include MPGN type 1 and 3, as well as again a mesangial proliferative or proliferative GM. So these would be classified according to the EM deposit appearance, whether we have highly electron-dense osmophilic appearance or less electron-dense than the one we recognize in dense deposits. This is, again, MPGN and C3 glomerulonephritis. These are the subendothelial deposits and the duplication of the basement membrane. You can see it very clearly here. Again, subendothelial deposits and duplication of basement membranes. You've seen this. And here you have more of subepithelial pattern of deposits. Here you have subepithelial and subepithelial pattern. This is androstriates type 3. Here you get intramembranous, subepithelial, more intramembranous, and more subepithelial pattern. Also, you get the basement membrane duplicate, two basement membranes. And within this type, you're going to get bi-immuno. You're not going to see only the subendothelial. You get subepithelial and mesangial. And as I've mentioned, it's common to see subepithelial humps also within this entity of diseases, as mentioned in post-infectious GM. This is a very nice subepithelial hump you can see here. So you have subepithelial deposits and this subepithelial hump. Clinical features of C3 GM are also heterogeneous, as much as their morphology, with 50% of patients retaining normal renal functions, but around 15% of them would progress to end-stage renal disease. There are some reports of recurrence post-transplant, but we don't know much about it. Both C3 nephrotic factor and mutations in the alternative pathway regulatory proteins have been detected also in the C3 glomerulonephritis patients, and hence, like dense deposit disease, it's part of the spectrum of the glomerular pathology. It's not characteristic of dense deposit disease. So C3 nephrotic factor is not considered a pathognomonic entity because it can also be seen in post-infectious GN, by the way, as well as C3 GN patients. Let's just take some time on C5-HR5 nephropathy because it's not worthy that these this entity, which actually was actually recognized because of the renal biopsy appearance, the presence of glomerular inflammation and isolated subendothelial deposits of C3. This group of patients are autosomal dominant. They have persistent microscopic hematuria. They have episodes of pharyngitic sympharyngitic microscopic hematuria with pharyngitis, and they have progression to end-stage renal disease, mainly in males. They were discovered, as I said, in Cyprus, and they had found over 100 people affected all over. And they do recur in transplant. Why are the factor H-related proteins important? Because they are associated with renal disease apart from C5-HR5-related nephropathy. Now, if we have mutations, extreme mutations, which are uncommon, then we are going to get what we have just described, the C5-HR5 deficiency. But the problem is that factor H actually could have polymorphisms. And these polymorphisms are can put you at risk of developing a renal disease or a C3-glomerulonephritis, but could also be protective against development of the C3-glomerulonephritis. Meaning that these mutations have been found to be protective, for example, in lupus glomerulonephritis, in IgA nephropathy, and in other immune complex mediated GN, like membranous and like post-infectious GN. But they can still put you at risk. So does it regulate renal complement deposition? It probably does, because complement factor H is practically the only molecule that is involved in down-regulating the alternative pathway activation on host structures that lack other surface bound regulators, for example, like basement membranes and kidney glomeruli. So if we have a complement factor H mutation, we'll probably end up in glomerulonephritis, a C3-glomerulonephritis. This is a very recent study where they have looked at the complement factor HR5 in C3-glomerulopathy, and they have found that it was actually quite prevalent and associated with renal impairment. This comes from Matt Pickering and Terry Cook group, which were first group which described the C5-HR5-related glomerulopathy. So you can see here, this is the factor H-related 5, which they have stained by immunohistochemistry in the glomeruli, and they have correlated it. They have found that it was very strongly expressed in patients with estimated GFR loss. It was also related to endocapillary hypercellularity within the glomeruli, again, with EGFR loss in another, this were in a transplant cohort with the recurrence of the disease. Since this type of diseases, its diagnosis is mainly based on the presence of isolated C3 in glomeruli, and this was the first definition we had, it needed a more thorough look into the biopsies and into the definition of what we consider a C3 dominant or an isolated C3 deposit. So in 2013, there was a consensus, there was a meeting with a consensus report, which mainly focused on the definition of isolated C3 deposits in glomeruli. And they have found the C3 only is actually an impractical definition of C3 glomerulopathy, because we have seen cases which were typical for C3 by serology, by genetic analysis, and by electron microscopy, but they had actually immunoglobulins on immunohistochemistry or in immunofluorescence together with the C3, and vice versa. Cases as post-infectious glomerulonephritis, where they could have isolated staining for C3 only, but their clinical features and patients improved and they had a self-limiting immune complex mediated process. So you cannot classify them as C3 glomerulopathy. So we were in a problem with this very strict definition of C3 only deposits. This study, which was published in KI, had showed that they had examined more than 300 biopsy cases with MPGN1, DDD, and MPGN3. And they have shown that with only one criteria, which is using C3 only, they have detected C3 glomerulopathy in 8% of MPGN1, in 50% of dense deposit disease, and in 10% of MPGN pattern 3. Overall, only in 14% of the cases. When they used a second criteria where C3 was dominant and you have only 1 plus immune globulins like IgM, the percentage of detection increased from 41 to 59. When they used that you can have C3 more intense than any other immunoglobulin by two orders, then the sensitivity came up to 80%. So in this consensus report, the definition was changed from not only C3 by immuno or by immunohistochemistry, but it needs to be C3 dominant and at least two orders of magnitude more intense than any other immune reactant on a scale of 0 to 3. What does this mean? It means this. This is positive IgG, but this is positive C3, and you can see the difference. So this is what we call the intensity in the staining, that you get a positive immune goblet, but if the C3 is much more dominant, if it's two times intense, then this is a C3 glomerulonephritis. So if I'm going to score this IgG as plus one, this C3 needs to be scored as plus three. If I scored this as plus two and this is as plus three, then this is would be a query immune complex mediated GN versus a query complement three mediated GN. So you need a very dominant and very frank C3 deposits in order to characterize that this is a C3 glomerulonephritis. Again, as you can see here by immunohistochemistry, here the IgG was almost negative and you can see very dominant C3 deposits plus three as well. What about post-infectious GN and C3? We've been alluding that we have that C3 glomerulonephritis can present exactly like post-infectious with a diffuse proliferative pattern, which could also be oxidative, meaning that it could have a lot of neutrophils in it. And by electron microscopy, we can have subepithelial humps. Post-infectious glomerulonephritis is an immunologic response of the kidney. It occurs following a non-renal infection, usually with streptococcal infection. It's considered to be a benign condition with a good prognosis and a limited clinical spectrum. Post-streptococcal glomerulonephritis, it has been always termed post-streptococcal glomerulonephritis, but we know that there are other strains of streptococci, group C and G, not only group B. We know that staph can cause it. We know gram-negative bacilli can cause it, mycobacteria, parasites, fungi, and viruses, and so on. So the term have changed to encompass all of these variants of microbes, which can cause the disease, and it changed into post-infectious glomerulonephritis. Over the years, post-infectious glomerulonephritis have evolved. Its exact incidence actually would be surprised that it's not known, because of course, very few patients are biopsied. And we have a very good percentage of subclinical disease. It's actually thought to be 19 times more common than the clinically overt disease, especially in endemic areas and in developing countries. In some developing countries, post-infectious GN remains the most common cause of acute nephritic syndrome in children. It has a genetic predisposition because it can occur in siblings and even subclinically. So one child can have the full-blown picture of post-infectious GN, while his brother or sister can have it subclinically. The epidemiology changed considerably during recent decades, as I've said, where we discovered that much more pathogens can cause it, especially also in developed countries like Staphylococcus aureus. However, patients in the developed world tends to be more adults and usually are more immunocompromised, like diabetic patients and alcoholic patients, as we are going to discuss later. The possible pathogenic mechanisms of post-infectious GN, again, a very well-recognized entity for us, but still with only theoretical pathogenesis. We don't know the actual pathogenesis of it. However, we believe that it's the deposition of immune complexes within glomerular tufts, but we don't know the pathologic antigen, and that there is an overlap between insight to immune complex formation as well as the circulation of immune complex, the deposits of circulating immune complex. Histology, it's a diffuse and global disease, means it affects all glomeruli, and within the glomerulus, it affects all of it. And it's a typical proliferative glomerulonephritis with a lot of inflammatory cells, plus or minus neutrophils. Please know that you don't have to have neutrophils to diagnose post-infectious glomerulonephritis. You can diagnose it by leukocytes, by macrophages, sorry, by lymphocytes, by macrophages. You don't have to have neutrophils. Neutrophils help, makes life easy. But when you have a lot of neutrophils, then this is an exudative pattern of PIGN. So neutrophils are not a must in the diagnosis of a post-infectious glomerulonephritis. By immuno, guess what? What are we going to get? We are going to get a C3 dominant immuno, whether by fluorescence or by immunohistochemistry. And these C3 deposits can be deposited anywhere, subepithelial or mainly mesangial or mainly on the glomerular basement membrane or combined. You can see the mesangial or on the glomerular basement membrane. When for those of you who reads in any text, you'll find that there are three patterns for the immunodeposits in PIGN, whether we have the garland pattern or the sky star sky pattern and so on. So again, this is a C3 dominant glomerulonephritis plus or minus immune globulins. So yes, most of the time we find IgG and C3, but also in a good percentage of cases, we only find C3, which can represent a more late stage of the disease. Maybe the immune globulins have gone and only the C3 is left. But in all cases, you can diagnose a post-infectious glomerulonephritis only by C3 deposits. You don't need an IgG with it. Don't need the immunoglobulins. Since the clinical onset of dense deposit disease is also preceded by acute infection, often an upper respiratory tract infection in approximately 1/2 of the patients, and in around also 50% of the patients, there were elevated anti-streptolysin OTT with this infective episodes. So, and C3 nephritic is not a specific serological marker because it can also occur, as I mentioned, with MPG and type 1. We see it in lupus, you see it in PIGN, although less frequently. Infection, the theory that infection can be a trigger and can unmask an underlying abnormality of alternative pathway. And this abnormality, in fact, drives the disease progression. What does this mean? It means, as we've mentioned, that not all the patients have severe mutations in their regulatory proteins of complement. Some patients have only polymorphisms. And polymorphisms play a role in the fine tuning of the complement when it gets activated. So I could have only a mild polymorphism and I get exposed to an infectious process. This infectious process is going to lead to the activation of the complement within the alternative pathway of complement. And then this activation of complement, when it comes to be regulated, then this is where the problem I have, or the defect or the polymorphism I have in my gene, is going to appear. And hence, this process of complement activation in these patients is not going to be properly regulated like patients who does not have this deficiency. So infection is a very important trigger of a C3 glomerulonephritis. And this is why C3 glomerulonephritis can occur at any age. And probably it's related to the local complement regulator factors in the kidney because it's usually associated with a post-infectious GM. So this abnormality is what's going to drive the disease progression. And hence, we have this subset of patients of post-infectious glomerulonephritis, which we've always known that we have this percentage of patients who are not going to follow a benign course, who are going to st- to develop a rapidly progressive course, we're going to end up by end-stage renal disease. We have these subset of patients with renal impairment and so on. Probably this subset of patients who has a slowly resolving post-infectious GN, or they have a PII GN with a poor prognosis, are the ones who have these defects in the alternative pathway. To sum up, what's the C3 dominant glomerulonephritis? C3 dominant glomerulonephritis is characterized by dominant C3 deposits in a biopsy, in the glomeruli. Whether these C3 deposits are isolated, means all immunoglobulins are negative, or there are immunoglobulins, but they are with a much weaker intensity than the C3. There is a requirement that this weaker intensity has to be two orders in the intensity. So C3 has to be stronger two times than any staining, any other immunoglobulin staining, which is present in the biopsy. By light microscopy, it has variable patterns. It can be proliferative. Usually it's membranoproliferative, but it can present like post-infectious GN with a full diffuse proliferative exudative pattern. It can also come crescentic pattern, and it can be like membranoproliferative glomerulonephritis, or it can be with an undetermined pattern. Undetermined pattern means it has a mix of all the patterns together. You cannot really categorize it into a specific pattern of GN. And by electron microscopy, can also get either the dense deposits, intra-dense deposits, so this will go within the dense deposit disease category, or you can have the subepithelial and subendothelial deposits with plus or minus the subepithelial humps. So these are the C3 dominant glomerulonephritis, which will encompass post-infectious glomerulonephritis, because around 30% of cases of PIGN are C3 dominant. Complement abnormalities are presumed to be transient in these patients or part of the recovery from infection. C3 normalization, C3 serum levels normalization should occur within 8 weeks. If it didn't occur, or if the patient still had persistent proteinuria more than 500 grams, this category of patients would be reclassified to C3 glomerulopathy if this is abnormality persisted 5 weeks. What does this mean? It means that at time of presentation, we cannot differentiate whether the patient has a post-infectious GN or a C3 glomerulonephritis. This is a fact of life, unfortunately. We have absolutely no way of differentiating at time of presentation. Morphology is similar, immune is similar, EM is similar, clinical presentation is similar, and even if you try to detect complement mutations at the time of presentation, as I've just mentioned, they could be transient due to the infection, and then they can disappear. How can we differentiate them? The only option we have so far is to wait and follow up the patient. If the patient abnormal C3 levels and proteinuria and renal impairment, the clinical presentation, persisted after 12 weeks, then this patient is not a classic post-infectious GN. This patient is a C3 glomerulonephritis. This is, till today, this is the only way we can differentiate between PIG and C3. What about dense deposit disease? Dense deposit disease, as I've mentioned, could be easily suspected on light microscopy. It does give a characteristic pattern, but of course some cases are subtle and can present only by MPGN. The dominant C3 deposits with really very weak negative or only trace immunoglobulins also should make you consider dense deposit disease. And it's highly encouraged that we really need to do electron microscopy, because we know, because of transplant, because this disease occurs mostly in young patients, and we know that it's 100% recurrence, while C3 has only around 30% recurrence post-transplant if it's only a C3 GN. So it really needs to be recognized as a separate entity due to the due to transplant. Also, a point on dense deposit disease. Dense deposit disease is not a disease of children only. Dense deposit disease can be detected at any age, up to 60 years old. This also tells you how much we really know about the mutations, or how much we really don't know about the mutations in C3 regulatory genes. And when would the disease onset occur, then it can occur at any time, because also you don't expect it or suspect it, but it's also very common in young adults, age early 20s, up to 30 and 32, and we have cases diagnosed in 45 years old and even up to 60 and 65 years old. So dense deposit is not only a disease of children, and in a young adult who's presenting with a history of hematuria and full-blown nephrotic syndrome, steroid resistant, it's one of the differential diagnoses. It's a rare disease, but still you would be surprised that it can, that some patients do have it. It's not that rare. What about immune complex mediated GN? We just said that proliferative glomerulonephritis, although it has IgG and IgM in it, and or IgM in it, is also C3 dominant. Any immune complex mediated glomerulonephritis could also be associated with complement dysregulation. However, this complement dysregulation happens only in a small percentage of patients. And so patients can present with an immune complex GN, and then their underlying problem in complement regulation shows up, and then they get transition occurs to C3 glomerulopathy. Still, this entity or this area is really very query, and these data have come from patients which were diagnosed first as immune complex mediated GN, and then on their follow-up biopsies they were only C3 dominant, and vice versa. By the way, there were patients which were only C3 in the first biopsies, and then by the second or the follow-up biopsies, they developed immune complexes. Whatever the scenario, if we have the criteria still sits, if we have a prominent immune complex glomerulonephritis, even if the C3 is dominant, the immune complex is dominant, the immune globulins with a dominant IgG, but you also have a strong C3, like your regular immune complex mediated membrane proliferative glomerulonephritis, this should be classified and treated as immune complex glomerulonephritis, not as C3. So the factor here is the intensity of the immune globulin deposits, not the C3. In all of these glomerulonephritis, the C3 is quite dominant. It's very bright, very strong, and very nice staining. The factor is the staining or the intensity of the other immunoglobulins. Then, of course, this entity is going to encompass C3 glomerulonephritis, and this will present around 66% of these cases where you would have only isolated C3, and these patients have an increased likelihood of C5 convertase dysregulation, and people who can use mass spectrometry, they do reveal the terminal complement components in the deposits, which is the C3DG. This is the terminal complement component present in these deposits. Finally, there is a very recent entity also relating C3 dominant glomerulonephritis to paraprotein associated GN. And it was described that in adults aged more than 50 years, if you have a C3 dominant glomerulonephritis, then you need to consider paraproteins or monoclonal gammopathies, and that in this spectrum, the C3 dysregulation here is actually caused by the abnormal or by the excessive light chains which are present. And we're going to discuss this again more in more detail when we come to discuss monoclonal gammopathies. So within the spectrum of what we call C3 dominant glomerulonephritis, we have post-infectious GN, which we cannot differentiate except with the follow-up of the patients. We have dense deposit disease, which is C3-glomerulopathy, which we can be highly suspected and suggested on light microscopy, and with a very strong isolated C3 deposits on immuno. But of course, the golden standard for diagnosis is by EM. We have C3-glomerulonephritis, which is the other group of the C3 dominant or strong glomerulonephritis, which is not dense deposit disease, and these are much more common than the dense deposit group. They are going to present with any morphology, but in this scenario, we're going to get the deposits, subendothelial as well as subepithelial. Then we have a group of patients who, if they are old and would present with this classic C3GN, we need to look for paraproteins in them because there is evidence that it could be related to light genes and that the problem in their complement is caused by the light, the abnormal light genes they have. And finally, it's not always easy to differentiate between these C3 glomerulonephritis and immune complex glomerulonephritis because, as I said, the intensity could be variable and, of course, techniques differs. The original fixation of the specimen is going to affect the intensity of the staining. However, we do have some immune complex glomerulonephritis patients which can undergo transition to C3 dominant glomerulonephritis or C3 glomerulonephritis. I just added this. This is just this paper was published this week in the Journal of American Society of Nephrology. And it's a very interesting paper because this is the first paper which provides a new step in the direction of that maybe we would be able to differentiate between post-infectious GN and C3 patients at the time of diagnosis. And these authors, this is a French group, and they have detected autoantibodies against complement factor B. And as we mentioned, to remind you, the complement factor B is a very important cofactor for C3 convertase and for the formation of the C5 convertase complex. And they have described that patients with acute post-infectious glomerulonephritis were actually almost 90% of their patients' cohort had autoantibodies against this complement factor B. However, this study had a very small number of patients, only 34, and it was all retrospective, so we don't have any prospective data on how these patients occurred. So whatever the drawbacks of this study is, this is a very important step into this direction. These also autoantibodies are not commercially available, and they still need to be the tests, and they need to be reproducible. But still, it's a very important step towards differentiation between PIGN and C3 because, of course, the management differs. I'm not going to get into any serology investigation or any treatment, but I just want to show you that patients who had received eclosamamb in the first with the TMA epidemic and with the typical HS epidemic and in treatment of C3 do interestingly enough do show staining later on for IgG and kappa light chains, which is consistent with binding of this monoclonal eclosamab to the glomeruli. We don't know what's the long-term consequences of this. What we don't know yet, as that we don't know also the long-term consequences of eclosamab treatment, is that what features on biopsy are best predictive of clinical course, how much immunoglobulin staining can occur in C3 glomerulonephritis before we can say that it's not C3, that it's immune complex mediated, how the site and appearance of the deposits relate to the underlying genetic and functional abnormalities. Why do some patients have only subendothelial? Why some patients have only subepithelial? Are the C3 fragments relevant? Does it make a difference if I have C3C deposits or C3D deposits? And is there any clinical significance of subepithelial humps? Why only some patients have these subepithelial humps while others don't? We don't know yet a lot of these questions. In brief, C3-Glomerulonephritis are a rare group of glomerular pathologies in which there is abnormal accumulation of complement C3 as a consequence of genetic acquired disorders of complement regulation, mainly occurring in the fluid phase. C3-Glomerulonephritis was suggested to encompass, this term encompass a range of conditions regardless of the light or electron microscopic appearance. So this is used to designate a disease process. When we say a C3-glomerulopathy or glomerulonephritis, that means we are referring to patients with complement-mediated diseases. So it's rather not just a set of biopsy appearances. And diagnosis relies only on renal biopsy, immunofluorescence, or immunohistochemistry findings, because light variable light microscopy findings and complement biomarker profiles are quite heterogeneous. So you cannot diagnose it by only the complement biomarker profile. You need to identify it first on biopsy, and then you can proceed to do the complement profiles for your patient. These patients can have acquired drivers in the form of autoantibodies, and these are the abnormalities most frequently associated with complement dysregulation. They have genetic variants in everything, in C3, complement factor B, H, I, C5H related a protein 1 to 5 genes. All of them are potentially causal. That's why I'm saying it's a very heterogeneous group. However, and both rare and common variants can coexist together. And so patients can either have the full-blown picture of the disease or be susceptible to the disease. The main central thing to the pathogenesis of C3, however, is convertase dysregulations. And as I mentioned, even with this very recent article, conditions such as post-infectious glomerulonephritis cannot be differentiated from C3-glomerulopathy by renal biopsy alone, which can actually confound early diagnosis and treatment, and we have to wait on these patients. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Wesam, for this very comprehensive presentation. Really very interesting and comprehensive. And we think from the clinical point of view, when we have MMBGN or C3 or immune complex, for immune complex, we have algorithms for diagnosis, infections, immunological, and paraproteinemia. And today, we just heard from you that paraproteinemia can occur with immune complex and it can occur with C3 glomerulonephritis. Yeah. So this is one of the very, very important, although the outcome is not good, and they after the term C3 glomerulopathy was coined since 2007, من 13 سنة لما C3 glomerulopathy ظهر على الوجود, أعتقد كان الناس متخيلة إن التريتمنت هتبقى أسهل. التريتمنت very difficult. الإكلوزوماب ما أظنش إن هو دواء ساحر, واحنا مستنيين يجي ادويه تانية تشتغل على الكومبلمنت. الحاجه الثانيه كل يوم والتاني يظهر باترن, يعني في C4 جلوميرولوباثي وC5 جلوميرولوباثي, يعني مش هنخلص بقى من الكومبلمنت. فلكن
لا هنخلص من الكومبلمنت, احنا بنلعب بيه. يعني C4 جلوميرولوباثي هي ما كانتش مقنعه قوي, يعني لان يعني ما اعرفش ما يعني, وهي it was just a single paper, but yes, we're playing يعني around a lot with the complement, and we still have to wait and see. And I think this is one of the entities which is going to be constantly changing. However, the fact is, my important message of this presentation, that membranoproliferative glomerulonephritis is not a disease. It's a pattern of injury. Be very much aware of this. There is no light microscopy features or diagnosis of MPGN. You have to do immuno. This is the only way then you can know what to do with your patient. If it's an immune complex mediated glomerulonephritis, please look very, very, very careful for infections before considering it what's between quotations primary MPGN, if it exists. I'm not one of the believers that this disease exists. I think that membrane proliferative glomerulonephritis is basically a chronic infection pattern of the kidney, or either related to paraproteinemia if it's immune complex mediated or C3. If it's C3 mediated, then you know where the possibilities and the prognosis of your patient. And a comment on management, even now the management, even when they have first started to use eclosamab, then they discovered that not all patients are responsive to eclosamab, because again, the response depends on the original mutation you have. And what's used now is you start with some patients with only mild proteinuria, they are for follow-up or hematuria. And other patients, you go on MMF. If you have more proliferative or response on the kidney or the proteinuria is progressive, then you start steroids. And then the last line of management is adding eclosamab if needed. And it's also a trial because not all patients would respond the same. So it's
what we have from the clinical point of view, if we have full-blown nephrotic, we start with, so long as there is no secondary etiology apparent from the investigation, we start, if the patient has frank nephrotic, we start steroid and MMF. This is the first line of treatment that we follow. Eclosamab is not available and very costly, and we cannot offer.
And this is an international consensus.
Yeah.
I mean, not only here. This is the international consensus.
And this is
nobody goes for eclosamab as a first line of management.
This is why in the well-equipped centers, they are searching for new complement targeting therapy more easy than eclosamab.
Exactly.
And I think the most difficult issue when we know that the original kidney disease is C3-glomerulonephritis, you are afraid of the recurrence after transplantation. But we don't change our practice at Mansoura Urology and Nephro Center based on complement. Yes, we know it is recurring, but what we do, we proceed for transplantation and then assess proteinuria, doing biopsies, using ACE and ARBs, all these. So we didn't change our practice based upon T3 or immune complex MBGN pattern. But as you mentioned, I should exclude grave causes like paraproteinemia ATC.
And I should exclude density-positive disease.
Yes.
If we have a doubt or a suspicious biopsy for a C3 dominant glomerulonephritis, DDD has to be excluded, because these patients, I can give you a long list of patients who are diagnosed by recurrence post-transplant. So even if they chose to transplant, they need to know that this disease is going to recur in over 90% of cases. So this is the importance of dense deposit disease. It's in transplantation. They're all C3-GN.
Alhamdulillah, it is extremely rare. 1 in a million, تقريباً أو حاجة زي كده. وحتى لو أنا شخص dense deposit disease, I'm going to transplant the case
that's what I'm saying, but it's always good to know.
Yes. Although some centers consider density deposit disease as contraindication transplantation, but this is center policy differs from center to center. Here we have a question.
Yes.
Do you say, Dr. Wesam, that density deposit disease can be presented with the morphological features of post-infectious, and the differentiation between them is when C3 comes normal?
No, because you can have an OC3 in post-infectious GN. The differentiation between them is that you will have to wait on your patient for 12 weeks. And if he did not improve, then we're going to consider that he's C3-GN. And if we have in doubt, then you will have to re-biopsy and see what's going on. And if it goes more with a dense deposit disease. So no, you cannot differentiate by complement level, because it's actually completely unreliable. And even in C3 glomerulonephritis, some patients do have a normal C3 level.
Dr. Dawla, تفضلي.
مساء الخير يا وسام. مساء الخير حسين.
هلا بحضرتك. تفضل يا فندم.
Thank you very much, يا وسام, على ال dense والintense information اللي خدناها النهاردة. اللي عايز أسأله في البوست انفكشنز احنا عارفين around 95% بي get cured spontaneous. الخمس هي اللي فاضلين. Are you assuming in
لا معلش الصوت بيقطع دكتورة دولت. الخمسة في المية اللي فاضلين وقت
وخصوصا ان 95 ايوه ال 95% اللي they get cured الكومبلمنت بيبقى واطي for about 10 days وبعدين يرجع back to normal. وال 5% اللي فاضلين ما قالوش ان الكومبلمنت بي persist to be normal to be low. ف how do you categorize them ال 5% دول؟ يعني انا اللي فهمت النهارده ان assuming ان هم هيطلعوا
الصوت انا الصوت عندي
رقم
اوكي يس هو what I understood from the question is how we're going to characterize the C3 this C3 subgroup again with the same thing زي ما هريك بتقولي it's not common ان يبقى الكومبلمنت ليفل بتاعهم في الكلاسيك بوست انفكتشوز جي ان مش common ان الكومبلمنت يبقى consumed for a long time وساعات اصلا مش بلاقيه consumed ومش والعيانين بتريكوفر and so on. العيانين اللي هيبقى الكومبلمنت عندهم persistently low أو they are not going to recover وهيفضلوا persistently with proteinuria and with a clinical picture then I'll have to consider إن العيانين دول are C3 glomerulonephritis. Let us bear in mind إن C3 GN is a chronic glomerulonephritis مش acute. It's not acute, meaning إن هي لما هتيجي مش هتروح في حاجة. ف it can be triggered by an acute insult إن هي post-infectious GN. بس عشان أبقى عارفة بقى العيان ده دخل في سكة الـ C3 glomerulonephritis ولا لأ, all I have now is his follow-up. العيان اللي هيتصلح وهيخف is a PIGN وراح له. العيان اللي هيبرزست and this persistence could be with a persistent low C3 level with persistent mild proteinuria حتى لو نص جرام بس for 12 weeks I'll have to reconsider بقى ان العيان ده is a C3 glomerulonephritis.
Right. يعني احنا كنا بنقول ان ال 5% دول they have persistent immune injury to the kidney بتاع الكومبلكس اللي عمل injury اصلا.
ما هو ده اللي كنا بنقوله ما كناش نعرف. فهو هي مش persistent immune complex injury هي persistent complement injury.
اوكي. لازم يعني لازم هيبقى complement persistently low في الفولو اب بتاعهم. At least يعني.
لا هي القصة يعني مثلا الفاكت اللي هو CFHR ده ما بقاش complement فيه قليل. فمش كله فمش كله مش كله بياخضع لهذه القصة عشان كده ان انا evaluate complement بC3 وC4 بس ده مش كافي. وكان احد الاسئله على الشاتنج هنا ايفالويت الكومبلمنت ازاي ده هنخليها في محاضره الكلينيكال بحيث هندي جزء عن عن اللاب دايجنوزيس فور كومبلمنت ابنورماليتيز. دكتور طارق طنطاوي عندك سؤال؟ في سؤال عندك دكتور طارق؟
لا يا بيه شكرا.
طيب اوكي دكتور دولت في حاجه ثانيه حضرتك عاوزه تقوليها؟
لا انا عايزه بس اشكر وسام على المعلومات الجميله اللي بتديها لنا دي بتعمل لنا يعني storming of our knowledge our original knowledge يعني.
لا هو هو هي فعلا بصراحه يعني state of the art و cut edge of information. لكن احنا عاوزين برضو من الكلينيكال بوينت اوف فيو ما نبقاش ترابد في موضوع الكومبلمنت. بقول لحضرتك مثلا كل شويه يطلعوا فينومينا جديده باترن يحطوا C4 وC5 ومش مش هنخلص من الكومبلمنت. فبرضه الكلينيكال
انا الكومبلمنت حقيقي بس هو ال يعني ذا تيك اواي مسج لو احنا عايزين نكونكلود ذا تيك اواي مسج ان احنا طول عمرنا عارفين ان في ديزيزز بتاعه الكومبلمنت اللي هو الدنس ديبوزيت ديزيز ده مش جديد علينا فده عارفينه. ودلوقتي عارفين ان في عيانين بيبقى عندهم C3 dominant glomerulonephritis يعني مشكلتهم seems to be more complement related rather than its immune complex related. فانا بقى عارفين ان العيان ده مش هيديني good prognosis ومش هقدر to target him by steroids من الاول و has a high rate of recurrence post transplant compared to the immune complex. This is هو ده اللي احنا محتاجين نعرفه for now.
We don't have ما هو بيضيف للأحزان يعني هو بيضيف للأحزان والكومبلمنت على فكرة يعني أنا عشان نقفل الحوار الكومبلمنت ده من طبعا important component من innate immunity وأول ما طلعوه كانوا بيقولوا ده النار فاير كومبلمنت يعني فاير هو فعلا فاير فاير للدماغنا وفاير للريسورسز وفاير لكل شيء
quite complicated يعني
احنا بنشكر حضرتك وعشان الوقت بليز نموف لل للنكست بارت من حلقه النهارده اتفضلي يا فاشل اوكي
احنا لسه عندنا وقت انا قلت طيب ثانيه واحده معلش ثانية واحدة مش عارفة المحاضرة ايه
مش مشكلة اتفضل خد وقتك دكتورة دولت
نعم
اعتقد ان احنا ان شاء الله يوم السبت اللي هو بكرة الدكتور مجد الشرقاوي هيتكلم على المانجمنت اوف فوكال اند سيجمنتال جلوميرولونيفريتس الساعة 7:30 اعتقد حضرتك برضو جهز الممبرنس بقى بحيث ان احنا كل اسبوع ناخد مانجمنت من النفرولوجي اسبكتس وبعد كده ممكن ناخد اللوبس ويعني هنمشي واحده واحده هنمشي بارلل بحيث نخلص نحاول نخلص الكورس الاخوه اللي معانا جاست اناونسمنت لغايه ما تروح وسام تجهز بالسلايدز ان احنا عندنا الاسبوع ده حافل جدا بكره ان شاء الله مع الدكتور مجد الشرقاوي الساعه 7:30 على الاف جي اس مانجمنت يوم الاحد الساعه 8 مساء بتوقيت القاهره بس مباشر مع الدكتور عمرو الحسيني من جامعة كنتاكي من أمريكا هيتكلم عن الهايبر باراثيرويديزم ويوم الاثنين هيبقى عندنا الظهر محاضرة متخصصة قوي عن الرول اوف نيفرولوجيست ان ليفر ترانسبلانت اكتيفيتيز ويوم الثلاث هنبقى مع الدكتور وسام هنشوف اذا كنا ناخد النهاردة بوست انفيكشوس ولا المرة الجاية هيبقى لو بس هنشوف الوضع هيبقى ايه فيبقى إذن في كل يوم في اكتيفيتيز موجودة بالإضافة للحلقات المسجلة اللي احنا بنضيفها على موقع الزمالة فأرجوكم يعني تابعوا الموقع وهيبقى فيه امتحان على النيفروباثولوجي كامل في نهاية الكورس موجود على الأونلاين بحيث نتست أور سيلف الفيديوهات موجودة ناخدها بالراحة ممكن كل يوم نسمع ربع ساعة نص ساعة بحيث الكلام ده كله يبقى مفيد إن شاء الله
إن شاء الله
Okay, this is a short talk. واحنا مو نقدر نعتبرها يعني
introduction. Okay.
Sum up. لا يعني sum up لحاجة. What we consider infection related kidney diseases. بس أنا هتكلم أكتر على يعني causes that we see common causes or regional causes rather than to cover the whole comprehension of infections. بس This is a very important issue. والأهم فيها that we forget that we have other infections and that we have important infections which are related to us geographically and climate. من the standpoint of infections, tropics and the subtropics area have due to the climate And not only climate, the climate and the socioeconomic status of the countries within this sector of the globe, as well as genetic variation, these three components makes you susceptible to a specific set of diseases which are probably infection related. We are living in one of these global examples of emerging and re-emerging infections with what we have now, طبعا يعني ال COVID-19 أو ال coronavirus infection. And there have been talks about the Hanta virus as well, and I'm going to cover it, the Hanta virus in China. The point is that we know that with the global change in climate and with the global change of people habits and with migrations and with genetic variations, we are having new diseases emerging diseases, and we have re-emerging of old infections we used to know years ago, which disappeared from the world, and then they re-emerged. Again, as I just said, an example is the Hanta virus. Infection-related kidney disease can actually target all compartments of the kidney, glomerular, tubulointerstitium, and to a lesser extent, vascular compartment. And the pattern of injury could be complete, could be quite variable. It could be glomerular, could present with an acute glomerulonephritis, with a mesangial, mesangial proliferative glomerulonephritis, with an MPGN, with a crescentic GN, with a collapsing FSGS, and with amyloidosis, don't forget it, and with fibrillary glomerulonephritis, secondary amyloidosis. Tubulointerstitial can give anything, acute tubulointerstitial nephritis, chronic TIN, granulomatous TIN, could be bacterial, viral, fungal, protozoic, or parasitic, any form of infection can get into the kidney. So it's quite a challenging diagnosis, and it's not easy at all. Hence, in a very good percentage of patients, we also cannot identify the underlying infection. If we come to discuss glomerular injury in relation to infection, the etiologic, whatever the etiologic events, at the end, it is an adaptive immunity reaction, and you have an antigen-presenting cells with B cells, autoantibodies, and antigen-antibody complexes with complement activation, of course, in some aspects, and in other aspects with circulating inflammatory cells. And you end up with either direct injury to the resident glomerular cells, plus or minus circulating inflammatory cells, release of all types of cytokines, and glomerular tissue injury. This is not a comprehensive list at all. This is just an example of infections which can be associated with kidney disease. As in, you can say, you name it, whatever infection which you could think of. And we should also add, of course, COVID-19, forgive me, but all of these infections are going to cause kidney disease. Let's start with bacterial infections associated glomerulonephritis, post-infectious glomerulonephritis, and infection-related glomerulonephritis. Now, this term is a recent term, and this term had been introduced to encompass all of these patients with an infection or with an infectious glomerulonephritis, which are not post-streptococcal. So post-infectious glomerulonephritis now is actually considered only for the post-streptococcal group, because the term post-infectious means that the problem occurs after the infection resolves. As we know, a latent period of 1 to 4 weeks, you generally have a normal state of health, and you come with an acute glomerulonephritis. While infection-related glomerulonephritis is a different story. This is a glomerulonephritis which is related to an active ongoing infection, which you might, by the way, do not discover it. And it covers a lot of entities. Shunt nephritis, endocarditis-induced visceral deep abscesses, like diverticulitis, osteomyelitis, foot ulcers in diabetics, and so on. So this type of infectious glomerulonephritis is related to an active ongoing infection, and it's not post the infection. So this is why it's called infection-related glomerulonephritis. Under infection-related glomerulonephritis, we have staphylococcus infection-associated glomerulonephritis, and this one is usually IgA dominant, not IgG. And we have low-grade persistent bacterial infection, as I said, like shunt nephritis, infective endocarditis, and deep abscesses. In these cases, usually present with... This is bacterial infection-associated glomerulonephritis. This is your classic infection-related glomerulonephritis with a lot of a proliferation, global proliferation, and a lot of neutrophils, plus or minus a crescent. You can see here, you can see the neutrophils, dominant neutrophils, again in the PAS, very nice proliferative, diffuse proliferative glomerulonephritis. You can have crescents, they are common. And here is a crescent, and you can have, again, a crescent full blown, or you can have segmental fibrinoid necrosis. And by immuno, as you see, we've just said, you're going to have dominant C3 deposits and plus or minus immunoglobulins. which are usually IgG. And by electron microscopy, you're going to get this characteristic subepithelial humps. See? Here. Humps, يعني اللي زي سلام بتاع الجمل. One of the variants of this entity, which has been first described as an atypical post-infectious glomerulonephritis, however, this term has been dropped, and now it's called IgA-dominant infection-related glomerulonephritis. Mainly, it's staphylococcus-related, so it's also called IgA-dominant staphylococcus infection-related GN. And this staph infection-related glomerulonephritis is on the rise. Why? Meaning that we see it more and more because we have an emerging drug-resistant strains of staphylococcus, and both nosocomial and community-acquired staphylococcus infections are reported. And we have a growing elderly population with increasing prevalence of comorbidities, such as diabetes, such as morbid obesity, and other possible diseases. So the classic example of it, or when it was first described, it was described first in association with diabetic glomerulosclerosis. You see in this patient had a florid reaction, extensive numerous neutrophils with endocapillary hypercellularity, and you can see that the diabetic nodule, the glomerulosclerotic nodule, while here this patient had diabetic glomerulosclerosis and very limited segmental endocapillary few leukocytes, which still also would be diagnosed as IRGN on top of diabetic glomerulosclerosis. So it doesn't always, in diabetics specifically, doesn't always give you this florid picture. We see it in the elderly population in general. By the way, even if they don't have other morphology of other systemic disease and their biopsies, sometimes they just come with a pure infection-related glomerulonephritis, just had a biopsy of a 68-year-old patient, not known diabetic, not only hypertensive, who presented with acute kidney injury and proteinuria. This is a very common presentation in these patients. They usually present with renal impairment. They have, by the way, a poor prognosis for mortality rather than a morbidity, and they don't resolve nicely. It's not a benign disease like the classic post-infectious glomerulonephritis, which occurs in children. And only a sector of them has low C3, by the way. A good percentage of these patients does not have low C3 in their serum as well. Why is it IgA dominant? Because staph mainly deposits the immune complex. The circulating immune complexes are formed of IgA. And as you can see here, we're going to get IgA deposits. But by biopsy, you're going to get the subepithelial humps, by electron microscopy, which is going to tell you that this is probably a post-infectious GN. We've been asked this, we've discussed this this entity when we've been discussing the IgA nephropathy. And as I said, yes, sometimes we don't know if this is an IgA nephropathy or it's an IgA dominant staph infection. We don't know. So some of these patients remain a diagnostic enigma. Of course, we do our best. But if you cannot find an underlying infection, and again, your patient is not going to develop an IgA nephropathy at the age of 70, especially for us, before our own patient population, where IgA nephropathy, it's an issue in Europe and it's an issue in Asia and the States because they have a lot of IgA nephropathy. But for us, I would consider what would be more common in my population, and what would be more common in my population is an IgA dominant staph infection related GN rather than an IgA nephropathy, especially of all the features which suggest an infection related glomerulonephritis. In these bacterial infections also causes tubulointerstitial nephritis, and sometimes with or without the glomerulonephritis, and of course they cause acute pyelonephritis and chronic pyelonephritis, and we're going to cover this in the tubulointerstitial disease. Leptospirosis. Now, leptospirosis is one of the re-emerging infectious diseases among both animals and humans, and it has the potential to become even more prevalent with the anticipated global warming, which we are already living in. This is a leptospira in the glomerulus. You can see how it looks. And this is now the prevalence of leptospirosis in the world. By the way, we have leptospirosis. They are common in the Delta region. Usually they are not biopsied because patients actually come in septic shock. So, and they are septicemic. However, out of the few patients which were biopsies, leptospirosis causes acute tubular necrosis. You can have interstitial hemorrhage. It can, at a later stage, it can give you interstitial nephritis. Usually does not give a lot of glomerular changes. They are not remarkable. But sometimes it can give a proliferative glomerulonephritis with early neutrophils. It's one of the infections you have to consider because we have it, especially in Bahira. Salmonellosis, again, a type of infection which we forget. And you have around 16% of patients with salmonellosis can come with abnormal renal function. And the main renal lesions are pyelonephritis, by the way. So these patients can present with pyelonephritis, can present with acute tubular necrosis, and can have some mesangial proliferation in their glomeruli. I'm going to mention it again when we come to schistosoma, where an exudative glomerulonephritis can occur. You can have a full-blown post-infectious GN if this patient also is a Bilharzia positive mixed with schistosoma infection. Shigellosis, you all know shigellosis, and we know that acute tubular injury can occur to dehydration, but we also know that shigellosis causes hemolytic uremic syndrome, especially in children, and is responsible for a lot of outbreaks. Brucellosis, again, an underestimated, usually forgotten cause of infection. Brucellosis, not always properly treated because it has a very special way of management. Patients have to receive two types of antibiotics at least and so on. Or either it's missed in the diagnosis from the beginning. And rarely, this is not common, but this comes from a patient actually which was diagnosed as brucellosis and was not adequately treated and 6 months later came with a full-blown vasculitis. So brucellosis is one of the infections which can give you necrotizing granulomatous vasculitis in the kidney. So always consider it because we also tend to forget it and it's also a common infection. Dengue fever. We don't have dengue fever in Egypt, but we have patients which come from the Gulf areas and from other areas which are actually endemic for dengue fever. Although according to the CDC map, Yes, Egypt is free, but all our adjacent countries, as you can see, are full of dengue fever. And of course, we have patients tourism from all over the area. Dengue is currently the most important, of course, this is old. It's not the most important human viral infection, but it's the most important human viral mosquito-borne infection of public health significance. So it's more important or has a public health significance more than the malaria. This disease is also mosquito-borne. And we have four serotypes of dengue fever. One serotype from then one to then four, only one of them would produce lifelong immunity. The immunity to the other serotypes lasts for a few months. So the saying that if you have dengue once, you're not going to have it again is wrong. Actually, the correct saying is that if you have dengue once and you're going to catch it again the second time, it's going to be fatal. So this is a serious disease. Dengue causes acute tubular necrosis, causes interstitial nephritis, can cause focal necrotizing glomerulonephritis and GN. Rarely, it gives hemolytic uremic syndrome. Of course, its mean differential diagnosis would include other infections like malaria, like typhoid, like HIV, like influenza. And in particular, it overlaps with leptospira and hantavirus infection. These three infections can actually mimic each other in almost all aspects, including the renal injury and renal histology. And they also, dengue fever comes in association with other infections, which even compounds the problem more. So malaria, for example, or out of 1,723 patients which were febrile in Sayan Hospital, 238 had dengue, around 400 had malaria, and 17 patients had both. Again, there is a reported dual infection with Klebsiella pneumoniae, and there were previous mixed infections, reports of mixed infections with leptospirosis and shigellosis. So dengue is a type of infection which does not like to come alone. It can add another infection with it. Hunter. Now, Hunter has been of recent interest, and a lot of people panicked when they saw that Hunter, that some they found some patient in China, which was recently diagnosed by Hunter virus. And Hunter is an emerging zoonosis. That means that we used to know it before, but it emerged again. It's a re-emerging zoonosis. Hunter viruses are rodent-borne pathogens. This is what we've known about them, and they are mainly transmitted through the feces of rodents. However, a few years back, new hosts are being discovered, which can carry Hunter viruses. They are endemic. They have endemic areas in Europe, in Euroasia, and in Eastern Russia. But with the emerging zoonosis, the distribution seems to expand, like with new cases in Africa. So according to the CDC and the WHO, the Hunter virus a few years back is now classified into New World Hunter virus, which causes Hunter virus cardiopulmonary syndrome, which is of course a problem within the what we are living in now with the COVID-19 epidemic, and hence the panic was around if we're going to have Hunter again. So we have a new world Hunter virus actually, and causes cardiopulmonary. The old one, which used to be endemic in Europe and in Euroasia and so on, this one used to cause hemorrhagic fever and renal syndrome. And of course, this is due to that it causes many vascular alterations and leakage leads to organ failure. So Hunters are mainly like the coronas with mutations, and we have a new version of the virus, which we have now. And there are 5 stages of the disease. Patients usually start by being febrile, then hypotensive, then oliguric, then diuretic, and then they recover. But of course, not all patients go through this. And biopsies from patients with Hunter, because we do still see the old world one with the renal affection together with the new one. So we have both. They present with a variable degree of acute tubular insult, but there are very few biopsies. Hepatitis C. Of course, I think we are all more or less experts when it comes to hepatitis C virus and the kidney. And you must have heard about HCV a lot, and this is one of my favorite areas in renal diseases, which is HCV. Diseases of the native kidney, we're just going to take a quick glimpse on it because we don't have time to discuss HCV in detail. However, the diseases of the native kidneys, which have been reported with that it's associated with hepatitis C, were membrane proliferative glomerulonephritis, cryoglobinemic or non-cryoglobinemic, focal segmental glomerulosclerosis, membranous fibrillary GN, and IgA nephropathy. Now, obviously, this report seems to differ from countries to countries. Maybe the relationship is in genetic predisposition, or maybe the differences rely in the genotypes of the HCV. We know, you all know, of course, that in Egypt, we have a completely different, the unique single genotype, almost single genotype of genotype 4. We're still doing studies, we don't know. However, the dominant HCV-associated patterns of renal disease we have are cryoglobinemic and MPGN glomerulonephritis, followed by membranous with few cases of FSGS and fibrillary GN. Just a few words on the cryoglobulins and why. What are these cryoglobulins consist of in patients with hepatitis C? Cryos are a unique antibody that is present as part of a cryoprecipitate. Why is it a unique antibody? Because this antibody is an IgM kappa rheumatoid factor, which is targeted against IgG. And this IgG is targeted against the HCV. Do we understand? Let's take it the other way around. So I have the virus, and this virus has a surface E2 protein on it. And this protein triggers an IgG response. But then this IgG immunoglobulin triggers another immune response where you have an IgM immunoglobulin with copper in it, IgM copper. This immunoglobulin is what we call cryo. So the cryoprecipitate is an IgM copper antibody, a polyclonal immunoglobulin, IgG, and HCV RNA as part of the immune complex. This is why cryoglobulinemia and HCV is known as mixed cryoglobulinemia. What is the mix in it? The mix in it is that you have a polyclonal IgG and you have another immunoglobulin, which is monoclonal, which is the copper IgM. Polyclonal means that this IgG is present with its copper and lambda light chains. Monoclonal means that IgM, this IgM antibodies has only the copper light chain and no lambda light chain. So this is what we mean by mixed cryoglobulinemia. What happens is that pathogenesis of MPGN-HCV associated, you know it, but I'm going to show you this just to underline an important feature. That mixed cryoglobulinemia, as you know, HCV is also lymphotropic, so it's on the surface of B lymphocytes. And so it is this proliferation of B lymphocytes from the hepatitis C, which gives you this IgM copper rheumatoid factor, RF. That's why you can detect cryoglobulinemia by RF, which is, by the way, much more reliable than the cryo test, which is done very bad all over the world. It's not only us. Cryos is a very, very sensitive test, and it's a completely unreliable test. So cryo negative does not mean anything. So you can simply do an RF for the patient because this is the main factor of the cryo. Although there are also some reports of patients where the rheumatoid factor is too low, so probably it's negative, it's undetectable. Anyhow, this is what we call type 2 mixed cryoglobulinemia because you have an IgM kappa element in it together with the IgG, and this is what gives you cryoglobulinemic membranoproliferative glomerulonephritis. The point is, this is a restricted monoclonal production of a certain IgM class, meaning that when you have cryoglobulinemia, you already started to have monoclonality, your patient already have a lymphoproliferative disorder, a disorder which can lead to malignancy. And this is what we're seeing now. These clones, this group of B lymphocytes, which have reproliferated and divided, and produced is producing the IgM kappa RF, does not go away with the DAA treatment of the HCV. So we very successfully eradicate the HCV virus, but the clones of the B lymphocytes persist. And hence, patients who are even HCV PCR negative comes again with cryoglobulinemia or with lymphomas, B cell lymphomas. So remember this, when you treat hepatitis C, you treat the virus itself, but you don't get rid of the persistent clones which the patient have, because these clones are already present in his circulation. So what triggers this clone at a certain stage post-treatment to cause cryoglobulinemia, we don't know. What triggers them to cause the B-cell lymphoma or with paraproteinemia and light chain diseases, we also don't know. But here is your link. This is why the HCV, your HCV-treated patient can be diagnosed easily 6 months, 1 year, 2 years post-treatment. They can come with an attack of cryoglobulinemic membranoproliferative GN, even with a negative HCV PCR. As I said, patients are not going only to come with, might not come only with cryoglobulinemia like this patient. However, this patient was not treated. This patient was a native, with a naive HCV patient, did not receive any treatment. And this patient had a full-blown cryoglobulinemia, as you can see, very nice PAS positive cryoglobulins in the glomeruli, but he also had amyloidosis in his kidney. You can see here PAS negative, and in the interstitium, see the his Congo red. So he had cryoglobulinemia and amyloidosis, and his amyloid turned to be kappa positive, and this patient had a small cell lymphocytic lymphoma. All the scenario is caused by the hepatitis C. So this is the important message I want to tell you. Don't be surprised. And if you have a patient with a history of HCV, please look carefully for malignancy. And please don't be surprised, or not just to drop it out of your mind, that your patient can come with a cryoglobulinemic vasculitis. Virus-associated glomerulonephritis, as you can see, they will include almost all the viruses we know. We know hepatitis B causes mainly membranous GN, but there are some reports in China that HPV can cause MPGN as well. And HIV is out of the scope of this presentation. It needs a separate presentation on its own. But we know HIVAN, and by the way, the spectrum of HIV-associated glomerulonephritis have exceeded just the fact of collapsing FSGS. And viral-associated glomerulonephritis can be either acute, subacute, or chronic, and can cover all patterns of glomerulonephritis. What about parasitic injury? Parasitic injury is an important entity, and you seem always to forget that you can have an infection by a parasite, which is going to give you a renal problem in the form of glomerulonephritis. And there are very known parasites which are considered main culprits of renal injury. Parasitic parasites, as much as they follow the same pathogenesis like any form of infection, have an added entity to them that they can cause an immune complex mediated glomerulonephritis. So they trigger a TH1 and a TH2 response, which would both can stimulate B lymphocytes. So you can have an acute inflammatory response, or you can have an immune complex mediated response. Again, we don't have malaria a lot in our country. It's not a prevalent disease at all. Malaria causes two major renal syndromes, which represents two extremes. There was this syndrome, which was known as quartan malarial nephropathy, and it was described as a chronic and progressive glomerulopathy that mainly affects African children. And then caused by Plasmodium malariae. And then we have the one caused by Plasmodium falciparum, which is acute renal failure associated with falciparum malaria in Southeast Asia, India, and Sub-Saharan Africa. I've included malaria because we get a lot of Sudanese patients, by the way, and 99% of Sudanese patients are malaria positive. Now, quartan malaria nephropathy is an entity which doesn't exist. This was a very old entity, which was based on circumstantial, clinical, epidemiological, experimental work, but nobody, they all failed to prove a cause-to-effect relationship. It's present in a very old textbooks, or if you looked up malaria in the literature, however, some African nephrologists, and they have argued heavily with me, believe 100% that this entity exists. Of the evidence that it doesn't exist, it had unexplained various pathologies in different countries. In Uganda, it was a proliferative glomerulonephritis. It was membranous in Nigeria. It was FSGS in South Africa, and so on. And for over 20 years now, we have no recent data on this entity, so it really doesn't exist. What exists, however, is MARF, or malaria-associated acute renal failure, caused by Plasmodium falciparum, but also Vivex and malaria. Plasmodium malaria can occasionally contribute for this renal impairment. MARF also includes that you can have an infection-related glomerulonephritis, and typically like your post-infectious glomerulonephritis, but usually eosinophilic, predominant, not neutrophils. So you get to see eosinophils. This is from a case I had, and this is from a case which was from Uganda. And in both of them, you can see the infection proliferative GN with a lot of eosinophils. The pathogenesis in MARF is mainly parasitized red blood cells. The red blood cells are parasitized by the plasmodium, and they cause aggregation in the peritubular capillaries of the kidney as well as in the glomerular capillaries. The important one for us is schistosomiasis. And unfortunately, all the new generation just doesn't consider schistosomiasis. Yes, of course, we've done a great effort in a controlling Bilharzia infection, but we do still have patients with schistosomiasis, and we still do see them. I don't need to tell you that Bilharzia is a chronic parasitic disease caused by blood flukes. You know this better than me. This were foreigners. And schistosomiasis actually has a very complicated immune response going through Th1 immune response to a Th2 dominant immune response, where you get granuloma formations where they can be hepatotoxic. Then you move to a smaller granulomatous formation because it's mainly a granulomatous mediated disease. And this immune response, interestingly, actually follows the stages of development of the worm, from cercari to schistosomula to adult worms up to eggs. The most important point is that glomerular hemodynamic changes occur and the antigens bypass the liver through portosystemic routes. And this causes impaired clearance of IgA. And as Dr. Dowlett mentioned last time when we were discussing IgA nephropathy, when she told me that could these patients be schistosomal? And yes, of course, I would consider schistosoma number one in these IgA dominant infectious patients as well, because we know that in schistosomal glomerulonephritis, we need IgA, or you could see IgA and it can act as a progression factor. You have to know that this literature comes from us, comes from Professor Barsoom. He's the one who's described all the classes I'm going to discuss in schistosomal nephropathy, and that these classes or this literature is a bit different from the Brazil one, although they follow our system and they refer still to the same literature, but they seem to have a different variation, or they report a different variation in their patient population. In schistosomiasis, we have five classes of glomerulonephritis, and these five classes are dictated by the site where you can have immune complexes, and they are caused by both schistosoma hematobium or schistosoma Mansoni worm antigens. Class one is an membrane proliferative glomerulonephritis. Class two is typical exudative GN, and this is the one which I said is associated with salmonellosis infection, because salmonella hides in the cutis of the worm, so the combined infection can give you this. Then we have a membrane proliferative glomerulonephritis pattern, and we have FS GS, and usually in these you get a dominant IgA deposits rather than IgG or a IgM, and this should make you consider schistosoma. Again, falls in the differential diagnosis of IgA nephropathy, of course. But again, as I said, we have to consider what's relevant to our own population first, and we can easily exclude if the patient has schistosomiasis or not. And then we have stage five, which is amyloidosis. And amyloidosis in this patient is secondary amyloidosis or amyloid A type. Recently, in the last few years, we're seeing a new phase of schistosomiasis in our patients, where patients are coming as a granulomatous tubulointerstitial nephritis. Still very rare, still very few patients, but look at this patient. This patient came from Asyut University, and you can see the granulomas, extensive granulomas with actual mericidium and calcified ova in his kidney, in his renal parenchyma, and extensive eosinophils. This patient, interestingly, had membranous glomerulonephritis as well. We don't have membranous in our original classification of schistosoma nephropathy, and this is very verified because this patient was phospholipase positive. So this patient was unlucky enough that he had a primary membranous glomerulonephritis together with his granulomatous schistosomiasis. And it was the massive proteinuria, it was a full-blown nephrotic syndrome, which actually brought his attention to his rising serum creatinine. So he presented with the membranous, which he developed. But this membranous is not related to Bilharziasis. Of course, we know that schistosomiasis and HCV is linked together. And now that we are getting rid of hepatitis C, we managed to control very well schistosomiasis, but we still have some patients, and patients with both history can develop associated combined lesions, like this patient who had a cryomembranoproliferative GN and amyloidosis, but his amyloid was secondary. So to sum up, infection-related kidney disease can be a challenging diagnosis due to variable patterns of injury and different pathogenesis. With the emergence of new infections and the emergence of old ones with different strains, we will continue always, unfortunately, to be one step behind. I think we are living in a great example of this, of what really it means that we are one step behind. Infections should be included in your differential diagnosis of any form of renal presentation, of acute glomerulonephritis, of chronic glomerulonephritis, of unexplained acute kidney injury, and should be ruled first in cases of small vessel vasculitis. So if you have a small patient with a pathology of a small vessel vasculitis, as we're going to discuss in the vasculitis, you have to rule infections first. Well, thank you.
طبعا انا بعد هذه المحاضره الممتعه خليني بس يعني الاول احيي دكتور وسام على الفيري كومبريهنسيف اوفر فيو وانا هرجع للنقطه اللي حضرتك قلتيها الانفكشن في كل بلد مختلف عن الثانيه يعني انا لما كنت في امريكا من 10 سنين في 2008 2009 قلت لهم انا عاوز ادي محاضره على الشيزوميس ان كيدني ترانسبلانتيشن ولا واحد في الديفيجن هناك في هارفارد كان يعرف يعني ايش الشيزوميس فاذا الانفكشن
ولا لحد دلوقتي يعرفوها
لا
احنا حتى النيو جينيريشن عندنا ما يعرفوه
لا هي على ما يبدو ان هي ديكلايند يعني احنا كان عندنا اكسبيرينس طبعا دكتور رشاد برسوم واحد من الجريت فيجرز في
المركز المنصور
لكن دكتور صبح برضه من الناس اللي هم من اعظم الناس اللي نشروا في هذا الكلام لانه استابليش ذا لايف سايكل بتاع الشيزوميس عندنا في معمل في مركز الكلى وكان بيعمل اميون كان بيعملوا اميون الكاسودا الانجين والانودا الانجين في التيشوز عشان تكونفيرم الشيزوزومال وفي باع طويل جدا في الليتريتشر في القصه ديت الشيزوزومال بدا العالم الخارجي يهتم بها لما ظهرت في فرنسا حوالين بحيره هناك او حوالين منطقه هناك في الميه ف الانفكشن ممكن يروح ويجي بس البلاد المتقدمه هي البلاد اللي بتنجح في توريديكيت الانفكشن على سبيل المثال شيزوما جابونيكم لو سألنا أي واحد شيزوما جابونيكم موجودة فين يقول في اليابان حاليا شيزوما جابونيكم في الصين لكن اليابان عملت إريديكيشن لأن اليابان عندها جود هيلث سيستم
موجودة في البرازيل برضه على فكرة في شوية في أرياز علقوها في البرازيل
العلاقة ما بين الإنفكشنز يعني مثلا الملاريا أنا كتبت ريفيو أرتكل على الملاريا أند كيدني وزي ما حضرتك قلتي مصر الحمد لله يعني ما فيش فيها ملاريا للموسكيتو وعندنا ما فيش فيه الكلام ده لكن انا لما عملت ريفيو للتريتشر طبعا دكتور رشاد كان عامل شغل كبير جدا في الملاريا والتروبيكال نفروباثي انا لما كتبت في الريفيو بتاعتي وده كان الحاجه اللي ادد على التريتشر اللي قبل ما الريفيو اتكتب عملت كومبريهنسيف ريفيو ما بين الترانسبلانتيشن والملاريا واكتشفت انه كثير من الايمون سابسيف دراجز زي الكالسيوم انهيبيتورز وغيرها لها انتي مالاريال افكت زي ما السايكلوسبورين ثبت في الاكسبيرمنتال مودلز انه له انتي شيزوزومال افكت فالعلاقه ما بين الانفكشن والكيدني علاقه فيري انتريكت وانا yes. بحيي حضرتك ان انت ما يعني ايه يعني ما انتهتش القصه عند بوست ستريبت كوكل ولا شيزوزومال اتش سي في لكن كل المسج اللي انا عاوز اقولها كل بلد بتبقى عارفه ايه المور بريفلنت انفكشن ولابد تساتسفاي نيدز يعني احنا لما كان يجي لنا نفروتك سندروم مش عارف اسمها ايفالويشن من غير ما اشوف الاتش سي في ربنا يسهل والاتش سي في بقى ريديكيتد تماما بعد ضرر انتي فايرال دراجز فكل بلد بتكاتيجورايز الانفكشن وعشان تقول برايمري جي ان مثلا لابد تاكسكلود الكومن انفكشن اللي هم عندهم لما كنت في الاردن في مؤتمر الاردن عرضوا حالات بروسيلا ريليتد جلوميرولوباثي وكان الديفينيتيف مانجمنت هي انتي بروسيلا تريتمنت فبرضه بنحط القصه في حسبان وخاصه لما يكون في ادد كلينيكال سيندروم من الكلينيكال برزنتيشن اخر نقطه عاوز اقولها قبل ما اسيب التعليق للحضور البوست انفكشنز اللي هو الكلاسيك ستريبتوكوكال جلوميرولونيفرايتس دازنت ريكير ومحاضره الدكتوره دولت على البوست انفكشنز جلوميرولونيفرايتس موجوده برضه كفيديو اتمنى الناس ترجع لها. اي سؤال، انا اي حد عنده سؤال او كومنت بليز يعني يرفع ايده واحنا نفتح ونشوف عاوز يقول ايه. طارق طنطاوي عاوز تقول حاجه؟
والله لسه الاسبوع اللي فات ازيك ترى وسام، بنشكرك على المجهود الغير عادي وال
يعني جبار، مجهود جبار،
حاجه جميله بصراحه. يعني لسه في حاله معايا هيباتيتس اي فيروس، وكان جايب جوندس وجايب رينال امبيرمنت، وطبعا الواحد يعني عشان تشخص هيباتيتس اي وهو يعمل رينال امبيرمنت وجوندس وكده كان في ستبس معينه. المهم كنا ريلاكتنت شويه ان احنا ناخد بايوبسي لان هو ريزولفد سبونتينيوسلي.
جميل،
ده برضو بارت تو بي ان اور جوب.
يعني تاكيدا تاكيدا لكلامك يا دكتور طارق، احنا كنا بندرس ان الهباتيتس اي والهباتيتس اي ما لهمش اكسترا هيباتيك مانيفيستاشن، طلع الكلام ده مش صحيح. وانت يعني انت بتتشالنج مين الوقت الاي، لان المشهور الوقت بقى الاي. يعني الهباتيتس اي ممكن ابريزنتد بكرايوجلوميك جلوميفرايتس واكوتينال فيلير، وده مش نادر. الهباتيتس اي بوست ترانسبلانت له قصص كتيره وبيتعالج بريدكشن الاميون سبريشن وريبافيرين. فحكايه ان الاي والاي اكسكلوسيفلي اكس هيباتيك فيروسز، الكلام ده فيه كلام وخاصه على الاي. لكن الاي انا كنت عاوز اسالك، هيباتيتس اي بوزيتيف وكان الرينال مانيفيستيشن ايه؟
هو جايب رينال امبيرمنت الكرياتين بتاعه راوند 2، وجايب هاي سيرم بيليروبين و
تمام. اتكلم عن رينال
والفاتيج. رينال هو الرينال ما كانش حاجه في اليورين اناليسيس، مش في حاجه، السونار طبعا مش باين حاجه، لكن هو الكلو بتاعي كان هو الهباتيتس اي. ولما حصل بيحصل سبونتينيوس ريميشن او بيحصل ريكفري، بدا يحصل امبروفمنت للكيدني فانكشن.
لا انا عاوز اقول لك على حاجه ممكن تبقى دي نون سبيسيفيك، لان اي حالات بتعمل كوليستيزيس الكيدني تيبيولز بتبقى بريدسبوزد للتوكسيسيتي. يعني الاكوت تيبلر انجري از كومن، ريليتيفلي كومن اند نوت ان كومن في وجود الكوليستيزيس. فانا عشان كده كنت بسالك اليورين هل فيه بروتونوريا ولا لا، لان ممكن البروباثي اللي انا اعرفه الاي الاي، لكن الاي بالنسبه لي يعتبر جديد جدا.
لا لا ما كانش فيه بروتونوريا، لا خالص ما كانش فيه كلول حاجه زي كده. يعني كان التفكير كله حاجه يعني، لان هو الايج بتاعه 19 years، وهو بياكل طبعا في جامعه وبياكل بره وحاجات زي كده، فهو ده الكلو بتاعنا. لكن اليورين السيدمنت بتاعه ما كانش فيه اي حاجه تقول ان في حاجه، هنقول مثلا حاجه من حاجات الجلوميرال ريجنز او حاجه.
كان الدكتور
ان الكوليستيزس حد ذاتها او فيري هاي بالروبن ليفلز كان كوز تيوبولار انجري.
الدكتور شفيق عشان بيحصل
استراكشر. الدكتور طارق، الدكتور شفيق احمد العماد معانا اهوت، وكاتب في التعليق بتاعه وي هاف كيس او بوست هيباتيتس اي فيروس انفيكشن جلوميرولونيفرايتس ويز نون فالمينال ليفر انجري. يا ريت لو الدكتور شفيق معانا افتح عليها معتصم بعد اذنك نسمع منه. دكتور شفيق اتفضل. اتفضل.
السلام عليكم.
وعليكم السلام.
اهلا ورحمه الله وبركاته.
This patient young patient came with hepatitis A virus acute kidney injury and severe proteinuria and he developed liver injury and severe jaundice but with normal coagulation factor, the prothrombin was normal. Then he improved he need about 1 month dialysis to improve conservatively. Yeah. And the complement was low, then improved, returned to normal complement C3 and C4.
جميل. حالة challenging، وأنا أنصح يعني أن تكتب
هتكتب إن شاء الله.
إن شاء الله. في أي دكتورة دولة حضرتك تحب تضيف حاجة؟
لا أنا بشكر الدكتورة وسام جدا على الفانتاستيك ريفيو للبوست انفكشنز، وي ار ويتنج ان نسمع كمان من المحاضرات الثانية إن شاء الله.
إن شاء الله.
إن شاء الله.
أعتقد يعني ما فيش كلمات تعبر عن الشكر والامتنان للدكتورة وسام على هذا العرض الشيق. فعلا أنا استمتعت جدا النهاردة، حلقة ممتعة للغاية، وإن شاء الله على موعد مع الدكتورة وسام يوم الثلاثاء القادم الساعة 7:30 مساء. واقول لكم يعني ايه، مع السلامه، وسعيد جدا بهذه الحلقه ونشوفكم دايما على خير
ان شاء الله. مع السلامه.
مع السلامه.
شكرا جزيلا. شكرا. مع السلامه.